Good morning. I'd like to welcome you to worship service at St. Stephen's Church this beautiful first Sunday of autumn. Our opening sentences. Thanks be to God who gives the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Our processional hymn this morning is Turn Your Eyes Upon Jesus.
The songs this morning are going to be a little bit new, but they're easy to pick up, so I encourage you guys to sing along.
Please be seated. I'd like to welcome you all to St. Stephen's this morning. My name is Russell Wall, and I'll be the lay reader this morning for our service. I'd like to thank a few people who have made this morning's service come together and be possible. We've got Lennis on the PowerPoint back there, and Jeremy on sound. And music this morning is by Amy and Isaiah. And thank you guys for it's going to be a great music service this morning. With that, let us begin our service. Dearly beloved brethren, the scripture moveth us in sundry places to acknowledge and confess our manifold sins and wickedness, and that we should not dissemble nor cloak them before the face of Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, but confess them with an humble, lowly, penitent, and obedient heart, to the end that we may obtain forgiveness of the same by his infinite goodness and mercy. Wherefore, I pray and beseech you, as many as are here present, to accompany me with a pure heart and humble voice unto the throne of the heavenly grace. And the general confession we will say together. Almighty and most merciful Father, we have erred and strayed from thy ways like lost sheep. We have followed too much the devices and desires of our own hearts. We have offended against thy holy laws. We have left undone those things which we ought to have done, And we have done those things which we ought not to have done, and there is no health in us. But thou, O Lord, have mercy upon us, miserable offenders. Spare thou them, O God, which confess their faults. Restore thou them that are penitent, according to thy promises declared unto mankind, in Christ Jesus our Lord. And grant, O most merciful Father, for his sake, that we may hereafter live a godly, righteous, and sober life, to the glory of thy holy name. Amen. Almighty Father, who of thy great love to men didst give thy dearly beloved Son to die for us, grant that through his cross our sins may be put away and remembered no more against us, and that, cleansed by his blood and mindful of his sufferings, we may take up our cross daily and follow him in newness of life, until we come to his everlasting kingdom, through the same thy Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive them that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. O Lord, open thou our lips,
and our mouth shall show forth thy praise.
O God, make speed to save us.
O Lord, make haste to help us.
Glory be to the Father, to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost.
As it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
Praise ye the Lord.
The Lord's name.
Holy God, we praise your name.
Please be seated for our first lesson.
First reading is from Exodus chapter 16, verses 2 to 15. The whole congregation of the Israelites complained against Moses and Aaron in the wilderness. The Israelites said to them, "If only we had died by the hand of the Lord in the land of Egypt, when we sat in the flesh pots and ate our fill of bread. For you have brought us out into this wilderness to kill this whole assembly with hunger." Then the Lord said to Moses, "I'm going to rain bread from heaven for you, and each day the people shall go out and gather enough for that day. In that way, I will test them whether they will follow my instruction or not. On the sixth day, when they prepared what they bring in, it will be twice as much as they gather on other days." So Moses and Aaron said to all the Israelites, "In the evening, you shall know that it was the Lord who brought you out of the land of Egypt. And in the morning you shall see the glory of the Lord, because he has heard your complaining against the Lord. For what we are, that we complain against us." And Moses said, "When the Lord gives you meat to eat in the evening, and your fill of bread in the morning, because the Lord has heard this complaining that you utter against him, what are we? Your complaining is not against us, but against the Lord." Then Moses said to Aaron, "Say to the whole congregation of the Israelites, draw near to the Lord, for he has heard your complaining." And as Aaron spoke to the whole congregation of the Israelites, he looked toward the wilderness, and the glory of the Lord appeared in a cloud. The Lord spoke to Moses and said, "I have heard the complaining of the Israelites. Say to them, at twilight you shall eat meat, and in the morning you shall have your fill of bread. Then you shall know that I am the Lord your God. In the evening, quails came up and covered the camp, and in the morning there was a layer of dew around the camp. When the layer of dew lifted, there on the surface of the wilderness was a fine, flaky substance, as fine as frost on the ground. When the Israelites saw it, they said to one another, 'What is it?' For they did not know what it was. Moses said to them, 'It is the bread that the Lord has given you to eat.'" Here endeth the first lesson.
This morning we will say the psalm instead of singing it, and I will read the first lines, and the congregation can follow by reading the lines that are underlined. "Give thanks to the Lord and call upon his name. Make known his deed among the peoples.
Sing to him, sing praises to him, and speak of all his marvelous works.
Glory in his holy name. Let the hearts of those who seek the Lord rejoice. Remember the marvels he has done, his wonders and the judgments of his mouth.
O offspring of Abraham, his servant, O children of Jacob, his chosen.
He led out his people with silver and gold. In all their tribes there was not one that stumbled.
Egypt was glad of their going, because they were afraid of them.
They asked, and quails appeared, and he satisfied them with bread from heaven.
He opened the rock, and the water flowed, so the river ran in the dry places.
For God remembered his holy word, and Abraham his servant.
So he led forth his people with gladness, his chosen with shouts of joy.
He gave his people the lands of the nations, and they took the fruit of others' toil.
That they might keep his statutes and observe his laws. Hallelujah.
Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. We will now have our second lesson.
Our second reading is from the book of Philippians, chapter 1, verses 21 to 30. As for me, living is Christ, and dying is gain. If I am to live in the flesh, that means fruitful labor for me, and I do not know which I prefer. I'm hard-pressed between the two. My desire is to depart and be with Christ, for that is far better. But to remain in the flesh is more necessary for you. Since I'm convinced of this, I know that I will remain and continue with all of you for your progress and joy and faith, so that I may share abundantly in your boasting of Jesus Christ when I come to you again. Only live your life in a manner worthy of the gospel of Christ, so that whether I come and see you or in absence and hear about you, I will know that you are standing firm in one spirit, striving side by side with one mind for the faith of the gospel, and are in no way intimidated by his opponents. For them, this is evidence of their destruction, but of our salvation. And this is God's doing, for he has graciously granted you the privilege not only of believing in Christ, but of suffering for him as well. Since you are having the same struggle that you saw I had, and now you hear that I still have. Here endeth the second lesson.
Please stand.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ is written in the 20th chapter of the Gospel of Matthew.
Glory be to thee, O Lord.
Jesus said, "For the kingdom of heaven is like a landowner who went out early in the morning to hire laborers for his vineyard. After agreeing with the laborers for the usual daily wage, he sent them into his vineyard. When he went out about 9 o'clock, he saw others standing idle in the marketplace. And he said to them, "You also go into the vineyard, and I will pay you whatever is right." So they went. When he went out again about noon and about 3 o'clock, he did the same. And about 5 o'clock, he went out and found others standing around. And he said to them, "Why are you standing here idle all day?" They said to him, "Because no one has hired us." He said to them, "You also go into the vineyard." When evening came, the owner of the vineyard said to his manager, "Call the laborers and give them their pay, beginning with the last and then going to the first." When those hired about 5 o'clock came, each of them received the usual daily wage. Now, when the first came, they thought they would receive more, but each of them also received the usual daily wage. And when they received it, they grumbled against the landowner, saying, "These last worked only 1 hour, and you made them equal to us who have borne the burden of the day and the scorching heat." But he replied to them, "Friend, I am doing you no wrong. Did you not agree with me for the usual daily wage? Take what belongs to you and go. I chose to give this last the same as I give to you. Am I not allowed to do what I choose with what belongs to me? Or are you envious because I am so generous?" So the last will be first, and the first will be last. This is the gospel of Christ.
Praise be to you, O Christ.
We will now say the Benedictus together. Blessed be the Lord God of Israel, for he hath visited and redeemed his peoples, and hath raised up a mighty salvation for us in the house of his servant David, as he spake by the mouth of his holy prophets, which have been since the world began, that we should be saved from our enemies and from the hands of all that hate us, to perform the mercy promised to our forefathers, and to remember his holy covenant, to perform the oath which he sware to our forefather Abraham, that he would grant us, that we, being delivered out of the hands of our enemies, might serve him without fear, in holiness and righteousness before him all the days of our life. And thou, child, shall be called the prophet of the highest, for thou shalt go before the face of the Lord to prepare his ways, to give knowledge of salvation unto his people, for the remission of their sins, through the tender mercy of our God, whereby the day spring from on high hath visited us, to give light to them that sit in darkness and in the shadow of death, and to guide our feet into the way of peace. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Please be seated, and I'd like to ask the Sunday school kids to come forward. How are you guys today? I have a question for you this morning. Who here has a birthday? Does everybody have a birthday? Everybody's got to have a birthday. So have you ever been invited to a birthday party before? In March. Yours is in March. Okay. So every, you're okay, and everybody's been invited to a birthday party before. So I have a question for you. Let's say you went to the birthday party and everybody got a really big piece of cake. And by the time they came to you, you got a tiny, tiny little sliver of cake. What would you say? Yeah, you might say you'd like a bigger one. Anything else you'd say? I think most people would say, that's not fair. Yeah, I want a bigger piece. You know, when I was about your age, I got invited to a birthday party. And the mom, I can't remember whose birthday party it was, but the mom, when she made the birthday cake, and this is a long time ago, so inflation isn't taken into account, but she put a nickel in every slice of birthday cake. Guess what? My piece of birthday cake didn't have a nickel in it. Yeah, so I kind of thought, hey, that's not fair either. But, you know, I think the mom maybe noticed I wasn't very happy about that, because I know she, I think she did slip me a nickel later on in the birthday party. But anyway, so that was kind of my reaction too, that, hey, everybody else got a nickel in their piece of cake and I didn't get one. So who listened to the gospel lesson this morning? Did you all listen to it? Or maybe you're busy doing other stuff. And who listened to the first lesson today? There's two things about those two readings that are really common. Everybody complained. In our first lesson this morning, it talks about, it's from the book of Exodus, when the Israelites escaped out of Egypt. And what did they do? They complained because they said, we've got no food, we've got nothing to eat, and God sent us out here, we're all going to die from starvation. They didn't realize what God had just done for them, and yet they still complained. And what happened in our gospel reading this morning? The laborers who went out to the vineyard, who knows what a vineyard is? Well, that's true. It's where they make the wine, but what grows in the vineyard?
Grapes,
right on. So that's, everybody went out to work in the vineyard. And some people started bright and early in the morning. Some people started at noon. And the owner of the vineyard called some people out at 5 o'clock in the afternoon. And then when it came to paying everybody, what did he do? He paid everybody the same fair amount. And what did the people who started at 8 o'clock in the morning say?
That's not fair.
Just like everybody at a birthday party who didn't get a big piece of cake. And what did the landowner say? That he was going to pay everybody the same amount. It was his vineyard and it was his money. And if he wanted to be generous to all, he would be. You have a question? Took your money. Uh-huh. So anyway, that's probably something like the vineyard workers felt. They felt that somebody had taken some of their money. They thought the guys who started at 9 o'clock in the morning thought they should have been paid more. So Jesus's parables are really interesting because they're a story, but the story is really about something else. Who do you think in that story the vineyard owner is? No. Who? When Jesus told that story, who do you think the vineyard owner was? No, it was Jesus. That's who represents the vineyard owner, Jesus. What do you think the vineyard is? Where the trees grow, but Jesus was really getting at the vineyard is the world. And who are the workers? Everybody who lives in the world. Everybody here this morning, we're all workers in the vineyard. And so what Jesus is telling this in this really important parable is that Jesus treats each and every one of us here the same. He loves us the same, and he values us each the same amount.
Jesus doesn't look at how much money you have. Jesus doesn't look at how old you are or how young you are. He doesn't look at whether you wear glasses or not, like you and me. He doesn't look at the color of your skin. Jesus looks in your heart. And you know what? He loves each and every one of us exactly the same. And we are all his. And that's something that is a very important lesson that we learn today in our gospel reading. So with that, I think you guys are ready to go to your Sunday school. And I hope you have fun, and I hope you learn lots. And thanks for listening this morning. See you guys. This morning's sermon is written by Philip W. Martin, and he is a pastor at the Epiphany Lutheran Church in Richmond, Virginia. And his sermon this morning is entitled, Not My Favorite Parable. The parables Jesus tells are often people's most favorite parts of the New Testament. And I think that's because so much of the time, the parables give us characters and stories that we love. Just think, for example, the parable of the Good Samaritan. People love the Good Samaritan. That story challenges us for sure, but it also leaves us with a nice warm feeling at the end. The stranger that everyone is supposed to hate and have low expectations for ends up being the hero. And people love the parable of the prodigal son. That's the one where the no-good, ne'er-do-well son asks for his inheritance early and goes off to squander every penny. But when he comes home to grovel, surprise, he's graciously and joyfully welcomed back by his loving father. The son was lost, but now is found. Kind of a nice, warm feeling. Even the parable we heard last Sunday from the Gospel of Matthew, which Jesus tells in response to his disciples' question about forgiveness, is a popular one. People like it. It doesn't really have a nice warm feeling at the end, but it doesn't need to. The story makes sense and justice is served. This is the parable where one guy is forgiven a huge debt by his master and then turns right around and rakes some other dude over the coals because he owes him a couple of dollars. Nobody wants that guy to win. Basically, he's a jerk. And sure enough, when word gets back to the master, the guy gets thrown in prison for being so unforgiving. Be all that as it may, I find not many people like today's parable. No one says this is their favorite, and it definitely doesn't impart a nice warm feeling at the end. There are no characters that really win our heart, and there's no sense of justice or fairness that people get what they deserve. Perhaps more than just about any other parable that Jesus tells, this parable of the workers in the vineyard disrupts our sense of reality, of what's right, fair, and equal. As humans, we are all but programmed to think of accomplishment and achievement in terms of merit and worth. We don't like the thought of people getting more than they deserve, especially in comparison to other people, even though it's not a lesson on how not to run a nation's economy. This parable about the kingdom of heaven messes us up. The first will be last, and the last will be first. Excuse me?
It starts with the landowner who goes out to find people to work in his vineyard. I lived in Cairo, Egypt for a while, and I remember there were certain street corners in the city where day laborers would wait with their tools for someone to come and hire them. I was a kid from the suburbs, and that was a sight I had never seen before. All these guys quietly standing there together, waiting for someone to want them. I imagined it to be a fairly precarious way to support yourself, much less a family. So the landowner goes down to the street corner and asks a few of these guys to help him. They're thankful to be selected, even though it will be backbreaking work, and he agrees to pay them whatever the going daily rate is. Okay, fine. Makes sense. For whatever reason, maybe he misjudged the amount of work he had to get done. Maybe they're not working as quickly as he hoped. He goes out about 3 hours later and hires some more. He doesn't give many details about what he will pay them. There's no contract or anything, but he does say he'll pay them whatever's right. Again, they're happy to be selected, and so off they go. This goes on and on all day until it's almost quitting time, when the landowner goes out one more time and finds a few more guys who haven't gotten any work. They're still standing there, tools around their waist, faces looking long, and realizing they'll be going home to their kids without any food that night. The landowner asks them why they're not working, and their response is sad to me, because no one has hired us. It's like they say, no one wants us. We feel unimportant, unvalued, and worthless. And then the landowner asks them to go in too. And at this point, we like this landowner, and we are liking this parable. We're getting the feeling that he is more concerned with pulling people into his vineyard than he is with anything else. Good feelings are starting. But then the whistle blows. It's the end of the day, and the landowner has his manager pay everyone the most interesting way. Those who had just barely broken a sweat because they came into the vineyard 1 hour before sundown get the full daily wage. And then, as the payout goes down the line, everyone gets the same thing. If he had some confidential payroll practices, things might go a little better. Hello, direct deposit? Understandably, this upsets the guys who got hired first, because they naturally think that they'll be paid, like the landowner said, whatever's right. At the end, they're the ones feeling undervalued, unappreciated, well, at least once they compare themselves to everyone else. As it turns out, this landowner guy is not about equal pay for equal work. It's like he considers working in the vineyard more of a reward than the paycheck he gives. The opportunity to be called and to serve is the most important part of it all. And his enterprise works on a system of surprise generosity that no one can see coming. It reminds me a bit of my high school graduation, where there were no valedictorians or salutations and no student speeches at all. The principal of R.J. Reynolds High School in Winston-Salem, North Carolina, was a man by the name of Bob Deaton, who was actually a longtime member of my home congregation. He had served as principal at Reynolds for 30 years, and apparently relatively early on in his tenure, he had done away with any and all accolades at graduation. No one was allowed to wear any sashes for such and such honor society or any extra tassels or badges, or anything else that might make them stand out above anyone else. All the graduates wore identical white gowns, so that if you were in the audience, you were looking at one big group
of equal achievers. There was no way you could tell class rank or athletic prowess or how active anyone had been in extracurricular activities. I thought all of this was normal, but I found out that Mr. Deaton's decision to do this was controversial at the time, and I think it still would be considered countercultural. But he was adamant that on graduation day, everyone looked the same. Someone told me that it was the parents of the top achievers who initially didn't like it. In the eyes of the world, thought Deaton, a diploma was a diploma. The achievement was graduation itself, no matter how you'd gotten there, and that's what that principal wanted to communicate. So it is with the kingdom of heaven, Jesus says. God's gracious decision to include us in his kingdom does not operate on principles of capitalism or merit or any kind of do-goodery. Grace cannot be calculated or estimated, and it definitely doesn't work when we try to compare ourselves with others. If we start to think we or anyone else is more or less worthy of it, God is moved towards those who feel undervalued, who haven't been chosen, who stand through life wondering if they've got any worth. God wants his people in the vineyard, in the kingdom. There are no ribbons or tassels or sashes here, no signs that anyone is more special or treasured, just the life that Jesus offers on the cross. That is a generosity that no one can see coming. And if that is what the kingdom of heaven is like, then the church bears the responsibility to proclaim and embody that as best as it can with the resources it has been given. We take heed of the messages we're sending, both intentionally and unintentionally, and ask if those messages communicate God's grace in the same way as that vineyard. We look at the programs we run, our personal interactions and relationships here and in our daily lives. We assess the use of our building spaces and church grounds and wonder, might certain people feel more valued here than others? Might there be ways to draw more people into the kingdom work? What messages are we sending when we do things this particular way? People are telling us that there is an increasing number of people in our culture, in our daily life, for whom the gospel is new, and for whom exposure to Christian community is not a given. How can congregations respond, especially congregations like ours that are made up to a large degree of people who are lifelong Christians? Can we find ways to tell and show to all people, whether they've been in the vineyard since childhood or whether they've just received Christ, that all gifts are welcome and valued? Can we assure each person that there is a way to fit into the glorious work of the body of Christ? That here, as Paul says, we strive side by side with one mind for the faith of the gospel? Can we hold in fruitful tension the need for longevity and experience, for the gifts of elders and those who bear helpful institutional wisdom, as well as new energy brought by people who've only been in the community for a little while? Can we remember, like Jonah in our first reading, that God is generous and forgiving in ways that sometimes make us uncomfortable and not make sense to us? It won't seem fair. It won't seem equal,
but it will be right. Only those who've ever gone into our scarcity at the church I serve have probably ever seen that our altar care team has put up a helpful little sign to explain how much wine the communion assistants are supposed to pour into each little glass. There's even a little sample glass, and someone has colored on it with a magic marker to make a certain ideal fill line. I'm not sure where the need for this came from. Perhaps there were complaints that some people were getting too little. Perhaps some were getting too much. However it came to be, I'm kind of proud of that little sign. It's a good reminder that we're all equal at our church in the really important way. At the communion rail, at Jesus's holy meal, at the foot of the cross, each person, regardless of who they are or how useless they feel, even if they think we sing too many old-timey hymns or not enough, even if they feel they don't have the right clothes to be here or that we don't make folks feel welcome, every one of us is graciously called forth and given for purpose for God. No, this may not always be people's favorite parable, but how can you really show preference when it comes to God's grace? There are no sashes, no special ribbons or accolades. Maybe from time to time, a nice warm feeling, but always a generosity you will never see coming. Amen. Please stand as we all say the Apostles' Creed together. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Let us pray. Lord, have mercy upon us.
Christ, have mercy upon us.
Lord, have mercy upon us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. O Lord, show thy mercy upon us.
And grant us thy salvation.
O Lord, save the King.
And mercy be with us and we
call upon thee. Endue thy ministers with righteousness.
And
O Lord, save thy people.
And bless thy inheritance.
Give peace in our time, O Lord. O God, may clean our hearts within us. Almighty God, you have created the heavens and the earth and ourselves in your image. Teach us to discern your hand in all your works and to serve you with reverence and thanksgiving through Jesus Christ our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. O God, who art the author of peace and lover of concord, in knowledge of whom standeth our eternal life, whose service is perfect freedom. Defend us, thy humble servants, in all assaults of our enemies, that we, surely trusting in thy defense, may not fear the power of any adversaries, through the might of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. O Lord, our Heavenly Father, almighty and everlasting God, who has safely brought us to the beginning of this day, defend us in the same with thy mighty power, and grant that this day we fall into no sin, neither run into any kind of danger, but that all our doings may be ordered by thy governance, to do always that is righteous in thy sight, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Our offertory hymn is Lord, the light of your love is shining. Please stand. Please sit or kneel for prayer, as whichever is most comfortable and appropriate for you. O Lord God Almighty, who rulest the nations of the earth, we humbly beseech thee with thy favor to behold our sovereign King Charles III, that in all things he may be led by thy guidance and protected by thy power. We pray thee also to bless William, Kate, and all the royal family. Endue with wisdom the governor generals of this dominion, the lieutenant governors of the provinces, and the legislatures of the Commonwealth and Empire, and all who are set in authority, that all things may be so ordered and settled by their endeavors upon the best and surest foundations, that peace and happiness, truth and justice, religion and piety may be established among us for all generations, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty and everlasting God, from whom cometh every good and perfect gift, send down upon our bishops and clergy and all congregations committed to their charge the helpful spirit of thy grace, and that they may be truly pleased thee, pour upon them the continual dew of thy blessing. This morning in our Anglican cycle of prayer, we pray for those in our church. We pray for the bishops and clergy and congregations in our companion diocese of Litchfield and Mayinga. We pray for our ecumenical partners in the Lutheran, Anglican, and the Ukrainian Catholic and Roman Catholic covenant. We also pray for the lay leaders, congregations, and ministries of the Parish of Emmanuel Regina. We also pray for the bishop, clergy, and people of the Territory of the People in the ACC. We also pray for Every Child Matters and remember the Indigenous children who did not return home for residential schools. And we pray for survivors and their families. And we also pray for truth, healing, and reconciliation. Grant this, O Lord, for the honor and advocate of our mediator, Jesus Christ. Amen. O God, the creator and preserver of all mankind, we humbly beseech thee for all sorts and conditions of men, that thou wouldst be pleased to make thy ways known unto them, thy saving health unto all nations. More especially, we pray for the good estate of the Catholic Church, that it may be so guided and governed by thy good spirit, that all who profess and call themselves Christians may be led into the way of truth and hold the faith in unity of spirit, in the bond of peace, and in the righteousness of life. Finally, we commend to thy fatherly goodness all those who are in any ways afflicted or distressed in mind, body, or estate. This morning we pray for those especially who have asked for our prayers, whether for healing, help, or comfort. And we also pray for those whom we hold close in our own hearts, and we also pray for those who are known to God alone. Praying especially this morning for those who have asked for our prayers, we pray for Marion, Glenn, Peter. We pray for Agatha, Ashton. We pray for Lloyd and Ryan. We pray for Wyatt and Jerry and those known only themselves. We pray that it may please thee to comfort and relieve them according to their several necessities, giving them patience under their sufferings and a happy issue out of all their afflictions. And this we beg for Jesus Christ, his sake. Amen. Almighty God, who has given us grace at this time with one accord to make our common supplications unto thee, and dost promise that when two or three are gathered together in thy name, thou wilt grant their requests. Fulfill now, O Lord, the desires and petitions of thy servants as may be most expedient for them, granting us in this world knowledge of thy truth, and in the world to come, life everlasting. Amen. So I thanked everybody at the beginning of our service, so I don't think I will, unless I missed someone, I don't think I did. And the announcements, they're up on the screen. So there's the men's and women's coffee, and next Sunday is 10:30 a.m. service with the BCP morning prayer. Is next Sunday Thanksgiving? No, it's not. It's another. I'm a week behind, so. I'll just have a quick look here. If there's any other people here that have any announcements, doesn't look like it. Okay, there's one announcement here. Church cleaning. There will be a general church cleaning of the church and kitchen on October 17th. So that's a little ways away, but maybe mark that on your calendars now already if you are free. That starts at 9:30 on October 17th. I'm not sure what day of the week that is, but the 17th is the day to mark. And the more people who join in, the quicker it will be. So please mark your calendars. And if you could, that would be great if you could come and help with that. If anyone is interested, we can go to the Legion for lunch and return to finish off after lunch. If that works for people, that would maybe be a nice outing. And if there's any inquiries, you can contact Val, and it's in the TGIF if you need her number. And then it says lunch. There will be Ukrainian lunch at the museum on October 11th, $10 per person. And you need to pre-register by the 1st of October. If anyone wants to join the coffee ladies, please let Kathy Butler know. So that's, again, October 11th. A Ukrainian lunch at the museum, $10 per person. And there's the coffee hour, and I think that is about it. So that's all I have for announcements, and I don't think anybody else has any. So I think we can move on to our recessional hymn. But please stand for the grace, first of all. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Ghost be with us all evermore. Amen. Go forth in peace to love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Amen.